Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
And let's go before the Lord. Father, we just thank you, bless you, praise you, give you the glory, all the honor that we come into the house of God and get to hear the word of the Lord tonight, Lord. We don't want to hear from a man, we don't want to hear from a woman. Don't want to hear from a music director. Don't want to hear from anybody. We want to hear from the teacher of the church, the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us to be all that you'd have us to be. And we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Father, as we come before you tonight, how grateful we are to be in the house of the Lord. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're here to touch us, heal us, and strengthen us in every area of our life. As you bless us, we would ask that you bless all the churches that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, God, for that. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Bless them all. And they're our brothers and our sisters. And at no time do we think of ourselves as better than them, but we see ourselves co-laborers, workers together in one field. In Jesus' mighty name, we all in agreement say amen. Even though we don't see ourselves as better than them, I think this is the best church in the world. Period. If I didn't think that, I love you enough to send you somewhere that I thought was the best church in the world. Tonight, I want to share with you, every morning Deborah and I get up and have coffee together. She's my best friend. We talk. We sit in two chairs staring out at the front lawn and we talk, sometimes for an hour or two. And we talk about Jesus, and we talk about our lives, we talk about our feelings. We've been doing it for as long as I can remember. We always used to sit on the porch in Lake Arrowhead. We had a church up there, and talk, and drink coffee, start the day off with prayer, or start the day off with the Word of God. And lately, the conversation's been different because I'm facing things in my life that I have never faced before. I've never faced what it's like being 70 years old or coming up this next birthday at 70 years old. I've never faced in my life phasing out of something that I love more than anything, which is the church. I don't know how to handle that. I never in my life thought I'd ever hear the voice of the Lord make a statement like, if you love me and love the church, then you need to get out of the way for the next generation. That was difficult to hear the voice of God speak those words to me. I'm not, by the way, those of you who think that I'm saying goodbye tonight, I'm not. I'm just learning how to deal with these conditions that are changing in my life. Along with that, I'm dealing with some health issues, and they haven't been comfortable for me at all. I'm dealing also with some business issues that we have poured our life into and everything we have into, and they're absolutely stagnant. They are not doing anything. There is no results whatsoever. There is nothing in our life going on that is exciting at this time. We are at a place in our life that we have never been before. We are facing absolutely dull as can possibly be. And it's been a very difficult time on top of the not feeling well as the change of administration, which needs to happen, by the way, for this to be a generational church and for it to, our promises to keep the church strong and healthy and even stronger. God did give me a vision that is the faster I get out of the way, the more the church is going to double in size. And I'm holding him to that. And that's not easy. That's good on one part. It also feels real horrible on another part on the inside of me to hear those words. Why does it double when I leave? I don't know. It's just going to happen. So there's all kinds of issues, and I sat down this morning, had a cup of coffee with Debbie, and she had her coffee. Puppy jumped up on our laps, and we started talking about these issues, you know. They were just hard. There's nothing literally nothing going on, nothing happened. And it was just hard. I started to explain to her how I was feeling. And of course, I'm grateful that I have a partner in life that is full of the Word of God. I mean, thank God I have that partner. Because, you know, you start to look at the natural. And some of you that are looking at the natural get discouraged in your business, your home, or your marriage, with your children, finances. You know what I'm talking about. They can really bring you down. And we're such natural people. What we do is we look constantly at circumstances, trying to figure out what's going to take place for us to change. We calculate everything in our mind. We calculate how it's going to happen. Then all of a sudden, you come a time in your life when you just can't think anymore about all the different options. I mean, I sometimes look at her and say, well, here's plan number 87,046,042 plus 0.1. You ready to hear another plan, a scenario? God, you know, and it's just like crazy, just crazy. Everything has come to halt. Some of you are in here today, and you know what I'm talking about. Some of you are in here today, and you know, quite frankly, you're discouraged. You've looked at your life and you're waiting for something to happen, or something didn't happen when it should have happened. And thank God Deborah and I started talking about the Word of the Lord. Today, I want to share this message with you. It's called When Things Don't Look So Good. And I'd like you to write that down. I'd like you to make notes, because whether you're young or old, in your life, there's going to be times when the natural... Do you know what I mean by the natural? The circumstances of life. The finances, the checkbook, the boss, the business, the home, you know, the economy, political scene that goes on. All the natural doesn't line up with what you're hoping it's going to be like. And then you're going to look at life and you're going to be like saying to yourself, things don't look so good. And that's really where I was at this morning when Deborah brought up this verses, and they were really powerful verses. I thought I'd share them with you, because for everybody, whether you're young or old, these are important for you to hold on to. I, after all of the years, almost 40 years, preached the gospel, I had got my eyes off of that which was important. Listen to me. And I started every day knowing God, loving God, knowing everything's going to be okay, but my eyes were moving more to the natural than they were to the spiritual. Therefore, it was depressing me and discouraging me. Paul writes, and if you will, in 2 Corinthians, and then if you go there with me, go to the 4th chapter. He's starting to make statements, and when he starts to make these statements, he's talking about his life and the example that he and the other apostles are about, and what they look like and what they go through. He makes a statement, you know, those statements you've probably heard before, that this is really about the knowledge of Jesus and not about him. And then he goes on and he says that we have a treasure in these earthen vessels, and that's the excellency of the power of Christ. So he's talking about, even in the midst of problems that he is experiencing, Paul, that the answer is found on the inside, and it's the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you got to keep hold of that. In the 4th chapter, we won't have it on the overhead. In verse number 9, he says, you know, you're persecuted, but you're not forsaken. We're struck down, but we're not destroyed. Always caring about the body of the dying of the Lord Jesus, the life of Christ also may be manifested in our bodies. He's getting older. He's passing on. Things are down. It's kind of a depressing, discouraging. Things don't look so good. But at the end of the chapter, he starts to say something to every one of us. Now, I find this fascinating. God felt like it was so important what he was expressing, that it was pinned for you and I and preserved for thousands of years so you could look into the heart of God and see a key to your future. And in verse number 16, he says, after all of these things, we're persecuted, but we're not forsaken. We're struck down, but we're not destroyed. We're going to keep on going, that the glory of God be manifest. Then in verse number 16, the fourth chapter, 2 Corinthians, he writes these words, therefore, we do not lose heart. And this was the subject that Deborah and I had talked about. And it's interesting because the word therefore, you know, is therefore what he just got through saying. But I thought these words were really powerful. We do not lose heart. Why would he say that unless you could lose your heart? And using that as an example for us that you could forget about what God spoke to you, forget about what life is about, forget about the glory of God, forget about the power of God, and keep your eyes on the natural and get real discouraging and really give up on everything and you lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, and it's that way with every one of us that are in here, physically you're all dying. You might as well get that picture. But oh, thank God there's something taking place on the inside, because we're only supposed to spend a certain amount of time here on the earth. But in that time that we're on the earth, something fantastic is taking place that's on the inside of us. The inward man's renewed day by day. And it's what you do with the inward man that has a lot to do with your future. You have this life here. And what you do with that inward man that's going on, that's being renewed every single day, has a lot to do with how you're going to think, what you're going to come up with, and everything. See the word up there, heart? We don't lose heart. What he's really saying there is the word heart is an interesting word. It incorporates a lot of things. It's not the heart that beats in your chest. That's what he's talking about. What he's talking about is your emotions, all of your emotions. Talking about your very character and expressions, the very expressions of your body language, the very expressions of your words, the very expressions that you have because of your thinking, that inner man that makes you who you are. That's the heart. It's the very soul and the physical activities of your life. That's what the heart is describing. He says, when you lose your heart, you really lose everything and all the potential that God could have done while you're here on the planet. And sometimes we have a tendency to lose our heart in things. And I know I didn't lose it, but I was belly aching to my wife this morning about some things in my life that I didn't like. It wasn't that I was being mistreated. I'm not mistreated at all by anybody. I'm so honored in this place. It's amazing. And I'm so respected in the world. It's amazing. I'm amazed at that. I don't deserve any of it. But inside of me, I was losing heart because everything had come to a stop and a still, and everything had come to this dull, no activity situation. And I'm at the place where Dan's message meant so much to me this morning of endurance and patience. Oh, man. It was like Dan read my mail. He was having coffee with us this morning, and I needed to hear that. I'm going to share with you tonight a couple of quick principles out of the Word of God. Why you don't want to lose your heart. Now listen. When I say heart, I'm talking about you, your character. Remember, your attributes, your speech, your thinking, your language of the body, your feelings, your who you are. When you lose who you are, you lose the life you have. And he says that we could lose our heart. And I want to share why you don't want to lose your heart. Number one, your heart carries your life. Everything you are, all of your thinking, I already said that. It carries your attitude. It carries your character. It carries everything. There's this guy named David who became the second king of Israel, but the real king that God loved. The Bible makes a statement a couple of times about David that he is a man after God's own heart. I don't know, there's nobody else that I could see that was that way in the Bible, but God says that a number of times in the Bible about David. David wasn't perfect. David made a lot of mistakes, did a lot of sins, and David messed around too much. But you know, there's something about David, his heart, his who he was, his character, his attributes, his speaking, his vision, his sight. And the very thing that made David who he was the thing that caught the eye of God. He's a little boy on the hills of Judea, probably in his teenage years, or maybe even early teens, watching his father's sheep, who's a very wealthy man. And you know the story that a lion and a bear came and took the sheep, the little lambs, out of the flock. And David went out and caught the lion and the bear and killed them. The very character of David was that he was not going to allow something to happen that was wrong. He was not going to put up with something that was going to take place. Would his father ever know that the sheep had been eaten? Probably not. Would his father miss the sheep? Probably not. He was a very wealthy man. But David had something on the inside of him. He had a heart that said it's a right thing to do and a wrong thing to do, and I'm going to make sure. And he, listen to this, laid his own life at stake. Think about it. Who goes after a lamb to rescue from the mouth of the lion? Most of us would say, listen, Mr. Lion, go have it, but don't come back again. I'm not getting near you at all. And go hide from the lion as he eats the sheep, right? Or the bear. I mean, who's going to attack the bear and fight the bear? This guy lays his life down for something insignificant. He had a heart after the things of God. That's the way God is. He didn't look at the natural. The natural says, I'm running. The natural says, I'm hiding. The natural says, man, that's a lion that'll kill me. The natural says, that's a bear who will claw me and tear me into pieces and run from that and let him have the sheep or the lamb. But he doesn't. He kills the lamb. He kills the sheep. That's the very heart. And a lot of times we don't realize that the heart is like, if you will, the very glass that carries the water. And you know, when you have a glass, you have water inside of it, and you carry, or a soft drink or a juice or something that's carried by the glass. The very part that carries your life is the heart. And if you lose the glass, like anybody in this place ever had a glass of water or juice or something and dropped it? How about kids that drop their milk glass and they go all over the place? When the container, when that literal glass is broken, it's all over the place, and the water is dispersed everywhere and it becomes a loss. And it's the same thing with your heart in the things of God. That oftentimes what we do is we lose our heart because our eyes are on the natural and our voice is in the natural and our speaking and our thinking is in the natural instead of the supernatural. Yeah. Yep. And what God is looking for is the people to realize how important this heart really is. It's the very thing that houses and contains your life, your future. If he can get your heart, he'll get your plans. He'll get your family. He'll get your finances. He'll get your courage. He'll get your thinking. He'll get your hope. If he can get your heart, the devil will take you and run you down to the place where you cannot live in this planet any longer. Losing heart is something you and I cannot afford to do because it's like the glass that holds our life and everything that's in our life of any importance whatsoever. The Bible says, I'll just throw it on the overhead for you, in Proverbs 4, chapter 1, number 23. It says, keep your heart with, and then he doesn't just say keep your heart, He says, keep your heart with all diligence. Why would he say all diligence if it was easy to keep your heart? It's not easy to keep your heart. You know why? Because your heart contains the very spiritual attributes of God on the inside of you. And oftentimes, the negative, worldly, fleshly stuff of the world comes in and pollutes what God says, pollutes what God wants to do in your heart. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. In other words, here's this container you've got. Inside of it is all the issues of life. If you don't hold that container in place, then all the issues of life spill out. And all of a sudden, you've got it. And that's why you and I, sure there's issues in our life. Sure there's, if you will, tough times. Sure there's discouragements and frustrations. Sure there's natural things that take place. I'm not trying to say you won't have problems and trials and tribulations, but you got to get your eyes off of those things, because they will spill your life everywhere, and get your eyes back on who fills the heart. Is anybody listening? And that's kind of where we were at for a long time. My thinking, listen to this, and my speaking are contained in my heart. And if I lose my heart, my thinking goes astray, and my speaking becomes something that's horrible. Let's take a look at it for just a moment, because I'm going to make a statement to you, and you ought to write it down, because it's important for you. Here's something why we don't want to lose our heart. My thinking determines my outcome. Let me say it again. If you have lousy thinking, you will have a lousy life. Bottom line, the issues of life come out of your heart, and your heart, your thinking is good. If you're thinking you can't make it, trust me, you can't make it. If you're thinking you will never be anything, trust me, you will never be anything. If you're thinking you'll never have a chance, you'll never have an opportunity, you'll never make it whatsoever, you'll never make it, you'll never have anything. Your thinking is so important, because it literally is so important. It determines the outcome of your life. And if you have thinking that is constantly depressed and down and discouraged based on the natural world, have you ever turned on the television set and watched the news? The news is designed to tear you down, get you in fear, so that you're in such fear, you'll go back and watch it again the next night, hoping that it'll be better. But has anybody ever seen it better? It's never better. And the same problems we fought 40 years ago is the same problems, just amplified, that are on the news that you watch right now. And some people tune onto the news all the time. I'm going to tell you something, you can do it or not do it. I would tell you to turn the news off and get into the good news, and you'll find your life changing. Because as you think will determine the outcome of your life. I remember this couple, just a couple months ago, I met with his pastor for lunch. When we're having lunch together, he says, do you remember? And he gave me the people's name. I said, yes, and I laughed when I heard their name. He said, you know what happened to them? I said, no, looking like I'm like an idiot thinking they probably failed. Well, let me tell you a little bit about the people before I tell you what happened. Years ago, probably 30 years ago, when Debbie and I were young in our 30s, we had a church. They would come and visit every now and then. And this couple was a different kind of a couple. I remember having a meal with them one time, and during the meal, they brought out a book. And in the book was all of their thinking. They had pictures of their new car. In those days, it was a Mercedes. They had pictures of a motorhome. They had pictures of a big house. They had pictures of wealthy things, literally material things. I thought, how unspiritual is this? You know, this is just so ridiculous. And they made this statement to us. They said, God's going to bless us. We know it. We're tithers, we're givers. And God's going to bless us. And I remember talking to many people about them. They went from like church to church in those days, and we knew them, and they never really settled here at the Rock because we weren't into them having any kind of leadership because they were just a little too radical and too strange with their book and all of their beliefs. So I'm having lunch about 2 months ago with this pastor, and he says to me, he says, Jim, he says, do you remember so-and-so? And I said, yeah, and I kind of laughed thinking, you know, they were strange, they moved on. He says, you'll never believe what happened to them. I said, what? He says, a long-lost relative they didn't even know they had died and left all of the money to another relative of theirs, millions of dollars, and they didn't get a penny. He says, and then that relative got sick immediately and died, and they ended up inheriting millions of dollars. I said, you are kidding me. Why don't they go to our church? What a dope I was. 30 years it took them. I don't even know what kind of job he had. I don't know, it was some insignificant job. They were broke for 30 years, but they kept believing that God was going to bless them. You couldn't talk them out of it. You could throw them out of your church because they were too weird. But I'm here to tell you today they don't even go to church. They have millions of dollars in the bank. You know why? Because people aren't faithful. Their job wasn't faithful. And that looking at their material things for the last 30 years wasn't faithful. But God Almighty touched them in such a way that his favor took place in everything. See, what you think will determine the outcome of your life. And if you lose your heart, you're going to lose it all. So important for us. Notice what it says in Proverbs 23, verse number 7. Just the first part of this verse. For as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Don't lose your heart, because as you think in your heart, that's what you will become. It may not happen right away. It may not happen overnight. And most likely it won't happen overnight. But guess what? It's going to happen. It just has to happen. God will make it happen. Don't lose your heart. We're talking about why you don't want to lose your heart. Number one, your heart carries your life. Number two, my thinking determines my outcome. And it's what a man thinks in his heart, so is he. But I like this. Number three, if you have a numbering system, it says your mouth speaks your future. So your mind determines your future, but your mouth will speak your future. And a lot of times we just let everything go. You know, I'll never have anything because I'm uneducated. I'll never have anything. I don't have any degrees. I'll never have anything. I'm not smart enough. You'll never have anything because you really don't have anything in your life. You don't have any situation. You're not in the right kind of job. You're not in the right kind of city. You're born on the wrong side of the tracks. You'll never have anything. The problem with that kind of talking and speaking is it really limits the God that can do anything. All things are possible to him that believes. Does it not say that? So therefore, you and I have got to get our speaking in line with what our thinking should be. Because our mouth speaks your future. Jesus is talking in this particular situation. In Luke, the 6th chapter, verse number 45, and he makes this statement. Jesus himself, he says, a good man out of a good treasure of his heart brings forth good. Out of the good treasure of his what? Now, come on, everybody. Out of the good treasure of his what? Heart. A good man out of a good treasure of his heart brings forth good. An evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth evil. Out of the abundance of the heart, then we talk about this. Listen to this. The what speaks? The mouth. And all of a sudden, you'll find yourself just failing. I heard a story many years ago about this young man who worked for a gardening company in Mento. He was a Christian, just a young guy, worked for a gardening company, and he would go try to get business, you know, mowing lawns, taking care of things. Went to this guy's house. The guy's house was a hoarder. You know what a hoarder is? You ever see the television shows, a hoarder? The guy barely opened the door, came out, didn't want to talk. He says, sir, I'll take care of the front of your house. It's pretty much in the heart of town. And he says, I'll take care of the front of your house. And, and mow the lawn for you and take care of everything. And he says, I'll do it for $10 a week for you. The guy that's a hoarder on the inside, no, I'll do it for a dollar. The guy said, $1 a week? Not worth coming out here. It's not worth doing anything. But there was something about the old guy on the inside who was half hiding behind the door that he felt something for. And he says, okay, I'll do it for a dollar. Because it's not about what I have that makes me great. It's about what I do that makes me great. It's about how I do with him. Years went by, and every week he would mow that man's front yard, pick up all the trash and everything, and there would be a dollar underneath the door. So he went up to the door. The guy would talk through the door at him and say, there's your dollar. And he just did it, and everybody laughed at him. His friends laughed at him. Some of you need to do things that are just kind and good. Just start speaking that God's going to bless you. Because even though your friends will belittle you, and even though people will call you crazy, and even though people won't believe in what you have to say, I'm here to tell you, God's behind you. And it's not about whether you make money in this world. It's a whether or not God anoints what you do. And God opens the door. Years later went by. That old man died. He had nobody to leave the property to. He left it to that young man who was no longer a young man, but a young adult in his early 20s. And when the young man was found that it was left to him, the police had gone in to carry the body away. There was a will that was written for that man to have the house. He went in and he started cleaning out the house. It's a hoarder's house, you know. It had everything. You can think of everything he ever owned. Went back for years and realized the magazines that were in the house were worth a fortune. Back was an old motorcycle stuck in back, worth a fortune. He sold everything off and came up with thousands and thousands of dollars. And when he was cleaning, he moved a board and a floor and pulled it up, and there were $250,000 and $100 bills. Not only does the story not stop there, but let me tell you how the story goes on. The property had been zoned commercial for future development and sat right in the middle of the town. And this boy, who just did it for a dollar, ended up a multimillionaire just from the man's property and the money that he found in the man's house. Let me tell you something. When you start saying to yourself and looking at yourself and saying, I can't make it. This is just too hard. I'm just not smart enough. I just don't have the ability. I don't have the education. I'm certainly not going to be in the right place at the right time. You know, I'm just not one of those people that are ever going to make it. I'm here to tell you something. The God who created the heavens and earth, if you put your heart in him, he will see what you do. And he, like David, he will make you a king in your land. Come on, somebody. It's true. But you can't speak and lose your heart and start speaking, I'm ugly, I'm a failure, I'll never make it. Some of you are saying, I'll never have a man. I'm too ugly. I'll never have anybody love me. I'm too ugly. I'll never have anybody care for me. I'm too intelligent. I'm too ignorant. I'll never be anything. My mom was this way. My dad is just a luck of the dice. I'm just no good. Can I tell you something? When you speak stuff like that, you stop the God who created the heavens and the earth from ever doing anything on your behalf. You need to say all things are possible to him that believes. Come on, somebody. We're talking about why we don't want to lose our heart and how important it is. Let me just say this about the mouth also. Here's another one. If you're making notes, number three, your mouth will define or defile you. Your mouth will define or defile you. There was this man, and I'll just tell you the story in 2 Kings. I was just reading it before I came to church tonight. There was a great famine in the land. A lot of people don't know what a famine is. You don't live in a time of famine, but let me explain to you what it means. There's no food. The crops have dried up. Famine means there's no water. The wells are dried up. People are dying of hunger and starvation. We don't know what that's like. Other parts of the world do know what that's like, and you will find the world still has great famines where people suffer. There was a great, great and deep famine in 2 Kings, the 7th chapter. And Elisha goes and makes a statement. There was no food to be had, and there was nothing to eat. There was no water to drink. And he makes a statement in verse number 1. He says these words, the famine, he says, is great in the land. Everybody's starving. He says, but tomorrow morning, now listen to this, tomorrow morning there's going to be enough food in this land that bread will sell for a penny a loaf, and a bushel of wheat will sell for a couple of pennies. And a man next to him made this statement. He says, you gotta be kidding, that's a bunch of baloney. God could open up the heavens and pour out all that he could from the heavens, we still wouldn't have bread for a penny and all of that wheat for sale. One man believed God, spoke it. Another man said, no, it won't happen. Well, it just so happens the Syrians had been in the land raiding the areas, and they were just persecuting all of the people of God, and this prophet was speaking. And what had happened is that the Syrians had been camped down in this valley. And because they were camped in the valley, they had a lot of food, a lot of wealth. They had a lot of water. They had a lot of wine. They had a lot of bushels of wheat. They had a lot of everything you could possibly imagine. And four lepers made a statement. They said, we can go down into the camp of the Syrians and die and starve down there, or we can stay up here and die. But it might be if we get up from where we're at, four lepers, and we go down in that camp, maybe somewhere along the line before we die, we might be able to eat something. So these four lepers stand up and they walk down to the Syrian camp. And as they're walking, God takes their footsteps, makes them so loud that the, if you will, the Syrians go crazy thinking there's an army coming after them. They start to get worried. They start to get fussy. They start to argue among each other. They said, the armies are coming. You can hear them. And they grab anything they can and they run as fast as they could to save their life. And when the lepers get down there, everything is left. All the food, all the water, all the cheese, all the wheat, all the bread, all everything. They eat and they eat and they eat and they go back and tell the children of Israel. And the children of Israel are so starving, they run to get down to the valley. And you know what happens when they run? They run over the one guy that said, God can't do this, even if he opened up the heavens, and he gets trampled and he dies. And can I just say something to you? If you look at the scriptures, the prophet said, everybody else will eat, but you will not eat of this because you said that. Can I say this to you? Your mouth determines your future. It'll either condemn you, or it'll defile you, or it will define you. Your call. Let the mouth define you in the ways of the Lord. In Romans, the 10th chapter, in verse number 10, you just pop it up for me. For with the heart, one believes. Don't lose your heart. Listen to this. This is how you got saved. And watch this, unto righteousness. And with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Two things take place for your salvation. Your heart and your mouth. It's the same exact principle for the blessings of the Lord. Your heart and your mouth. And a lot of times we forget this and we let the conditions of the world, just like it depressed me, sitting there having coffee saying, you know, you're my best friend. Let me tell you, I'm feeling heavy. I'm dealing with stuff I've never dealt with before. I'm discouraged. I don't know. I know it's right, but I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what I'm doing. You know, we live in a house that I gave to the church. We don't even have a house to move to. Don't have anything, don't know where we're going, what we're gonna do. But you know what? My Deborah encouraged me today. She says, let's don't lose our heart. And she started talking about that. Don't lose your thing, because as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And watch the words of your mouth. They'll either define you or defile you. They'll either be a person that's going to get, God can make something happen, bang, overnight, when you don't think they can happen. Just like with that guy that was, mowing a lawn. He's a wealthy man. How? Not because he got all the education to everything right. It's because he believed God and God did something overnight. God is the God of the suddenly. And suddenly there was God on the scene. And suddenly something comes to pass. And you got saved by believing in your heart and speaking it with your mouth. And if you didn't, in a few minutes you can get saved. I want to make sure everybody's all right with God before you go, because you know we don't like to close the service unless we know that everybody's right with the Lord. So real quick, if you died tonight, I'm going to ask you a question. Answer it in your heart. Nobody will know but you and God. Is that all right? If you died tonight, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? And you can say to me, well, Pastor, you know, I don't believe in hell. That doesn't matter. That does not make hell go away because you don't believe in hell. Jesus talks about it. The Word of God talks about it. It's a very real place. Wasn't made for you. It's made for the devil and his angels. But guess what? I want you to know something. It is a very real place. Would you go to, just answer the question, go to heaven or would you go to hell if you died? You say, well, I think I'd go to heaven. The problem with that is nowhere in the Bible it says you could think your way into heaven. Some of you said, well, I hope I'd go to heaven, Pastor. I hope I'd make it. Guess what? Problem with that is nowhere you can hope your way into heaven. Nobody, like the greatest hoper, gets to go to heaven. Here's how you get to heaven. Some of you say, well, I love God a whole lot. If I love God a lot, I'll go to heaven. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible does it say because you love God, you get to go to heaven. It's not in the Bible. Some of you said to yourself, well, hey, wait a minute. I'm a really good person. I'm going to go to heaven because I'm pretty good. You know, I don't break any laws. Nobody's chasing me. I haven't done any bad things, and I'm really pretty good. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you get to go to heaven because you're good. You're not going to make it. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. Now, wait a minute. That means you can't get to heaven your way, and you can't get to heaven my way or some well-meaning church committee's way. You can't get to heaven, you know, any other way but his way. And he tells us in John, the 3rd chapter, how to get to heaven. He says, you must be born again. You must be born again. Interesting. For as soon as I use the words born again, everybody freaks out in American churches. They say, wait a minute, you know, born again? What is that? Born again people are weird and creepy and fools and, you know, they're nuts and fanatics. But that's not what Jesus is talking about. He's talking about simply this. Having a relationship with him with all of your heart and with all of your life. You have to give Jesus all of your heart and give Jesus all of your life to be born again. He won't steal it from you. Makes you a free will choice for you to choose this. He's not going to hit you in the head with a 2x4 and make you do it. You've got to be wanting to give him all of your heart and give him all of your life. I'll prove it to you. It's an all or nothing relationship. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus says, I'm coming again, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Man, listen to what I'm going to say to you. What did he just really say? He said, people that call themselves Christians that are lukewarm, just lukewarm, are not going to make it. Wow, that's a shock. Lukewarm, let's define it for you so you can understand, see if you're there. Little in, little out. You know, little up, little down, occasional prayer, token prayer every now and then, occasional visit to the church. You know, you're not involved with anything. You're not against God. Oh, no. But you're not wholehearted for God. God is something in your life like everything else, but he's not everything in your life. You haven't given him all of your heart then. You haven't given him all of your life. And somebody needs to love you enough, respect you enough, honor you enough, tell you the truth. Guys, listen to me. It's an all or nothing relationship. God forgive us in American churches. We have watered that down, but we refuse to water it down here at the Rock Church World Outreach Center. It's an all or nothing relationship. And it's your call and it's your choice that makes that. So here you are today in this safe and friendly place. We've laughed. We've heard the word. You were great listening to the word of God today. And you know, today you get an opportunity to give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. Why not take that opportunity in this safe, friendly place? Why not change the direction of your life? Why not get God on your side instead of you always opposing the things of God or having him in a distance? Why not get close to him so you can get blessed? Today it starts by giving God all of your heart and all of your life. You say, well, how do I do that? How do I give God all my heart? How do I give God all my life? Let's do it God's way. Not my way, not your way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. So in the moment, I'll count three. I'll go like this. One, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear that sound, bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is I don't want to go to hell. And I don't want to go to hell because I have Jesus in my head and haven't yet given him all of my heart and given him all of my life. Today is your day to give him all of your heart. Today's your day of giving him all of your life. And when you raise your hand, you're saying something. I want to give him all of my heart, give him all of my life. I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. I'll see your hand go up. Why is it important that I see your hand? Because Jesus said, if you confess me where? Before men. I'm a man. I'll confess you as mine before the Father. So today, you're going to have to make the statement. You say, Pastor, wait a minute. I'll be embarrassed if I raise my hand. I'll feel funny if I raise my hand. Yep, you will. Get over it. It's better to feel funny in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever and ever and ever. Today is your day of salvation. I'm going to count three, pop my hands together. You get your hand up, put it right back down. Who should raise their hand? If you've been running from God, you know, if you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, you know who you are, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your life, and there's a bunch of you in here that haven't done that yet, guess what? I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're saying to yourself, I'm not sure if I've ever really given him all of my heart, given him all of my life, well, why don't you make sure today is your day? All you have to do is get your hand up. We'll pray for you, and you can receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior and go on washed by the blood with a future that has God in it that'll bless you. One moment of favor with God is worth a lifetime of effort and energy somewhere else. All you need is that. And God's looking and wanting to bless you. But you're going to have to give God all of your heart. You're going to have to give God all of your life. I'm going to count to three, pop my hands together. All across this auditorium, family rooms are all full. So I'm looking back there. I can see in the family room, all across the auditorium, wherever you're at, back in this family room, wherever you're at. Here it is. I'm counting to three. One. Two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. There's six. Thank you. There's seven. Thank you. God bless you. There's eight. Thank you. Nine back over here. 10 in this family room. God bless you. Anybody else? 10 wise people. Anybody else? Real quick, hurry. Real quick. If you're thinking about getting your hand up, do this. I don't want to keep the people any longer. Anybody else? Real quick. One more pass through the church. And you're going to miss this, and you don't want to miss this. And you're saying to yourself, I should do this, and you need to. Anybody else? Real quick. There's 10 wise people. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise for 10 wise people. All 10 of you, real quick, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff, in other words. And here's what I want you to do. Bring a friend if you need to bring a friend. If you're sitting next to someone, give them the elbow and say, come on, I'll go with you if you need to go. And get in your aisle. I want you to bring your stuff. Get in the aisle. Meet me right here in front. And we'll pray together. We'll invite Jesus into our heart before you leave this night. You'll be born again, headed for heaven. Listen to this. And denying your presence in hell. If you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have, you can come too. It's not too late for you. Let's all stand and welcome them as they come. You come right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, give them a hand as they come. I surrender. Give them a hand. come and give them a hand.
Oh, to be my blessed Savior, I surrender.
We'll wait for you. We know it's hard for you to get here, but it's going to be better than anything. Come on, man. Give him a hand as he comes. Come on home. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Woo! You're a good man. Okay, all of you, thank God you've come. Look to your left. See this guy waving at you? His name is Pastor Joel. He's a really good guy. No weird stuff goes on. None whatsoever. Here's what he's saying. He's going to do something. He's going to pray with you to invite Jesus in your heart. He's going to give you some free stuff. We love free around here. This stuff will tell you what to do next. What to do is like third grade reading level. Now that you're a Christian, what does God want from you? That will tell you what that is. And then I love this part. He'll introduce you to a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. Want to help you get strong in Jesus. Don't want you to go back and fall through the cracks with your old buddies and your old friends. Want you to go on with Jesus. Want you to get blessed. Want you to, we're going to put you in a position where God's going to open up the heavens and pour out a blessing on you. It may take a few years, just like those other people, but guess what? God wants to bless you. That's what he does. That's what you would want for your children. Make a left turn, if you will, and follow Pastor Joel right over this way. Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.